morning.
Morning.
Just a couple of announcements to make this morning. The altar flowers are given to the glory of God and in honor of the George and Smith families. Birthdays, and they're given by Sandy. Hunger Action is still looking for soup, crackers, etc. And as I mentioned, every week monetary gifts are always welcome as well. One great shop hour of sharing offering is being taken through the month, so you can get your envelope for that if you haven't already. And if you do forget and the month seems to slip away, don't worry about it. Please just send it in anyway, and we'll make sure it gets to the conference office whenever you send it. The Easter flower, you can see the insert in the bulletin for the details. The cost is $9, and the orders are due tomorrow, March the 15th. So please call them in if you don't make it in today. The yearbooks are available out in Fellowship Hall. They're on the table out there. And the thought of the week is, nothing you wear is more important than your smile, which I think is really ironic when we're all wearing masks. It's hard to tell. You can just pretend you're smiling. Nobody will know the difference, right? So anyway, any other announcements this morning? Yes.
I just wanted to say that the sale of the far stage is still progressing, though slowly. I met with the zoning board on Tuesday night along with Tyler and the engineer, and so it's passed the zoning variances and all. Next, we move on to the planning commission, and they haven't scheduled a meeting just yet. And then following that, then we go to closing. So we are moving forward. It's just the borough of Irwin moves very slowly. So that's all.
Thank you very much. Yeah, that's good.
I'll leave it at that.
Well, we thank you for all the effort there, too. We know how much fun it can be to work with the borough and the city councils and all these other inspectors and all that kind of stuff.
It has been a joy.
We'll quote you on that. Anything else?
Surely towards transformation. we may call upon you no matter where we are or what we are feeling. Keep us mindful of your presence and trusting in your promise that you were working with us in the moment-by-moment unfolding of our lives. Amen. Will all those who are comfortably able please rise for the call to worship? There is something more. That sends us searching in the dark,
looking for answers,
risking a question.
We are drawn here
because God touched us,
gave us help,
whispered our name
here in this place.
We journey toward grace
and know that something more
is revealed in the love of Jesus' face. Please join me in the invocation. Almighty God, through Jesus Christ, you brought salvation to the world. Give us strength to believe in him, that we may share in his victory over the power of death and fulfill the purpose for which you have made us. For he dwells with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen.
Please be seated for our first hymn, number 565. Faith together with the Apostolic Affirmation of Faith, number 359. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended to heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. You may be seated. We have joys and concerns we'd like to share today. Everything just going really well. I said everything must be going really well. Well, I can share a joy. On April the 9th, the kids at Henfield are going back 5 days a week to school. So that's a joy for me, not so much for my son, but I'm celebrating every minute of it. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for being with us during times of trial and illness and during times of joy and celebration. We ask, Lord, that you remind us to call upon you each and every moment of our lives, whether we find ourselves swallowed by troubles or enjoying the blessings you provide. May we show you our gratitude and come before you looking for peace and for solace and comfort as well. Lord, we ask that you guide us to those better pastures that lie beyond the dark valleys. We ask this in your Son's holy name in the way that he taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. And forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Our gospel lesson from John chapter 3.
And just as Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness, so must the Son of Man be lifted up, that whoever believes in him may have eternal life. For God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, so that everyone who believes in him may not perish, but may have eternal life. Indeed, God did not send the Son into the world to condemn the world, but in order that the world might be saved through him. Those who believed in him are not condemned, but those who do not believe are condemned already, because they have not believed in the name of the only Son of God. And this is the judgment, that the light has come into the world, and people love darkness rather than the light, because their deeds were evil. For all who do evil hate the light, and do not come to the light, so that their deeds may not be exposed. But those who do what is true come to the light, so that it may be clearly seen that their deeds have been done in God. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, may the words of my message be pleasing to you and reflect your good in our lives. Amen. Years ago, there was a show on TV on the Animal Channel that I really loved, and it was a famous guy. His name was Steve Irwin. And I thought about him today. I think about Irwin, Steve Irwin. He was crazy about reptiles, and that's probably an understatement. Every episode, he would grab poisonous snakes and tell you how beautiful they were and hold them close to his face and do all kinds of stuff. He'd poke under rocks and find those big spiders and all that kind of stuff. And he would talk to crocodiles and things like that. You could tell, he just loved these animals. He wasn't afraid of them, but he did respect them. And he just had this way about him. He was very fun to watch, and he always told the people that were watching that his success and safety depended upon his respect and his understanding of the creatures. He just knew how much he could do before they would strike, how much they would do before they would not tolerate it anymore. He knew that some snakes could be held and handled very easily and safely if you just knew what you were doing, and other ones he was much more cautious about. He just knew and understood. He didn't take wild animals for granted, and he didn't let his guard down, which was amazing because he would hold the snake in one hand and be looking at the camera talking to it, and the snake would dart out at him, and he'd just bob his head a little bit. He was so much fun to watch, but he was also very concerned about the environment that the snakes and other animals would be found in. He always talked about them. I liked the show because he respected the animals. He respected creation. He was not out to exploit it, nor did he curse it when it turned on him. He got bitten a bunch of times. He got sprayed in the face. I remember that episode. Some kind of snake sprayed him and got in his eyes. And eventually he was killed by a wild animal. But I don't think he would have thought of that as something evil happened. Ancient Israel could have used Steve Irwin because they had their own serpent problems. For those folks, snakes always represented evil and temptation. All the way back to Genesis, the serpent was the tempter. The serpent was the one who led them astray. So therefore, that's this fear of snakes. And every generation afterwards had the same fear of snakes. Even today, fear of snakes is one of the most popular, well, not say popular, but one of the most counted fears among people. You know what the number one fear people have? Public speaking. I had to look that up, but public speaking is still the number one fear that people have, even ahead of spiders and snakes and death. They're afraid of public speaking, which is kind of unusual. I think that's kind of funny. That's kind of funny. But anyway, serpents, though, were looked at as these objects of fear and dread, because they could be anywhere, and they could strike, and they could kill, and they inspired this kind of fear in people, because people just looked at them kind of weird. And, you know, I still feel that way. I see a snake, and I don't see too many out in the wild. I haven't seen one out in the wild for a long time. I couldn't tell you the last time I saw one. I have never seen one in my own yard. After all these years, I've never seen a snake in my yard. But it's still, you go to the zoo or you see it on TV or the pet store sometimes. People like to keep them as pets and things. And I look at them and I'm like, I don't know. They're just not, I guess they have their own style or whatever, but not for me. But the people of ancient Israel had a fear of them. And it was a healthy fear in some ways, but it also could lead to an irrational fear as well. In our story today, the wandering people of Israel, they've left Egypt, they're wandering with Moses in the wilderness, and they're complaining. And this is the theme for the entire Exodus. They're complaining. Always complaining. The food's not good, the water, we don't have enough water, we don't have enough this, it's too sunny, it's too cold, it's wet, whatever. You name it, they complained about it. At least that's how the story unfolds. Well, in this story, they're complaining about God. They're complaining against God and Moses, saying, why did God free us from Egypt just to kill us out here in the desert? Just kind of, you know, just being kind of obnoxious about it. So they're complaining, even though God has delivered them with miracles and signs, they're still whining about it. God had enough with these petty, arrogant people. So according to the story, he sends poisonous serpents among them to bite them. And I always think about that, thinking, you know, it says very clearly in the text, God sent them. Maybe, you know, now if they were there all along, I don't know. But God says he sent them. So I can just imagine this big caravan of snakes heading for them, you know, from all directions. You know, I don't know. But they were out in the desert, so they were already there. There were already snakes there. But anyway, the snakes start biting people, as snakes will do when they are encountered by people, especially people that are afraid of them. People that would maybe kick and stomp at them and try to shoo them away, that kind of thing. As the snakes struck at them, Israel repented. Now imagine that. They're being bitten by snakes, and all of a sudden, oh yeah, we shouldn't curse God. We should be kinder. We should be more thankful. So they cry out to Moses, please tell God to help us. Please tell him to take away the snakes. Take away the serpents. They recognized that they had sinned against God, and now they were sorry. So Moses prays again for the stubborn people. And that's another theme of Exodus. The people sin and Moses intervenes. He prays for them. He calls on God and he says, I know there are horrible people sometimes and they do all kinds of dumb things. They say terrible things, but please forgive them again. And God gives him these really strange orders. He says, make a bronze snake and place it upon a pole and hold it up for Israel to see. Whoever is bitten is to look at this bronze serpent and be saved. Now that just, I mean, the whole story just sounds so strange. The bronze serpent, make this snake. It sounds weird. Why would God command this idol? Because that's what it sounds like to me when I read this story. You just kind of, you know, browse over that story. That sounds like a lot like the golden calf, right? Some kind of idol to be worshipped, some kind of symbol like that. But the snake was not an idol. It was a symbol of God's power. God created the snakes as well as the birds and the horse, the fish, all of those things. All these creatures came from the mind of God, even the scary ones, even the ones that frighten us. But God tells him to make this bronze serpent. The bronze serpent had power because God gave it power. The people were saved because they believed. That's why they were saved. The serpent didn't heal anything. The bronze serpent was just that. It's just a thing, an object. It had no power, it had no medicine, but the people looked at it and they believed because they saw the power of God. Now that's kind of hard for us to understand and think, what do you mean, just looking at it? But we still do that today. We look at an object and it reminds us of God. When I read this story, the first thing that came to mind was those old stories about Dracula. Now I know that's a really big tangent, but my mind works that way. It goes in tangents. Because remember, what was one thing that Dracula was always afraid of? What was it that would turn him away? The cross, right? Or specifically in the novel, the crucifix. You would hold that up in front of him, and he would have to go away. It would burn him. You know, they're all, you know how the story goes. You've all seen the movies, right? And when I think of the bronze serpent, I think that must have been how that power worked. That the people saw the bronze serpent, and then they were opened to God's power. God's healing power then was there for them. They could see it. Something that was somehow not visible was made visible in what they saw. The same way Dracula was afraid of the crucifix, thinking to myself, well, Christ is everywhere, so wouldn't Dracula have always been afraid? Well, no. When he saw the crucifix, he was reminded. the same way the Israelites were reminded. It was Israel that committed the sins of rejection and cursing God, so their affliction was brought on by themselves. They rejected God, and then the natural order turned against them. They had no protection from it. So they called upon God, and he turned his eye back to them. The humans were the ones that were evil, though, not the serpents. It's easy for us to blame the system or the tempter. It's easy for us to read the story and say, man, I hate snakes. And the snakes are to blame. And we read the story of Adam and Eve, and we blame the serpent, because the serpent was the tempter, right? He said the things that caused Eve to fall. But we seem to forget that it was Adam and Eve that made the decision to sin, no matter what the serpent said. The fact is, we commit our sins and no one else is to blame. God did not destroy the serpents. Rather, he made the people look at the image of the bronze to show his dominion over humanity and over creation. He could have just zapped them, right? Zapped all the snakes and made them go away, poisoned them, whatever. You know, there could have been any number of things that happened. But the snakes were still there. And as far as we know, they were there all the time. They don't mention them later on, but we know that there's still snakes in the desert even today. Even as the people watched the staff, the snakes were still there. It was the mercy of God and the faith of the repentant that weakened the venom and brought them healing. The people were still being bitten, but it didn't kill them. It didn't make them sick. They looked at the bronze serpent, and they were healthy. Today we're still afflicted by those same serpents. And I don't mean snakes. I mean the fangs in our flesh are the modern temptations. The venom destroying us are the sins that we commit because we let it go through us. We don't watch. We let sin overtake us. We get into situations. You know, we're overturning those rocks. We should leave alone, that kind of thing. And we find ourselves being committed to these bites. We're sick and dying from these bites we've received. And the death is slow and painful. And we too are called to repent and find something to give us that cure, something to give us that anti-venom, if you will. God has again given us orders to watch him for a glorious vision. And in this one, the bronze serpent, the symbol of power and God's authority, has been replaced by God himself in the form of Christ, held high upon the cross. Christ writhes in agony, and that draws the venom from our veins. We don't think about it necessarily that way, but it does. It pulls out the evil from within us. Our tainted blood is traded, purified by the innocent flow of his blood pouring down over the cross. Crucified man would be a horrendous sight, yet we have to stare and call upon God to heal us, to see the sacrifice that was made on our behalf. We have to force ourselves to look at the ugliness that we have created, because we were the ones that created the cross. It was people, it was sin that created the crucifixion, created the need for Jesus to be crucified. We have to gaze at his misery to gain our lives eternal. God gave his son for our sake, not to destroy, but to heal and to restore. And it just seems so strange to us, so almost counterintuitive, that something had to be painful, something had to be destroyed in order for us to have health. But it doesn't make sense, right? Right now, people are waiting in line to get shots, so that our immune systems learn how to kill a virus that's coming on. Well, how did they create that? How did that get made? Well, the virus had to be studied, had to be tested, had to be killed in various ways, and then doctors and scientists and so forth figured out how to make that work for us. So in a sense, all that time, death has been used to generate new life. And the death of Christ generates new life in us as well. The bite of sin is deep, and darkness is closing in around us. Some love the darkness, as Paul wrote, and it's all they know, and it gives false comfort to those who are dying to it. But God gives us light to show the serpents of sin for who and what they really are. You ever been bitten by something and not realize it till later? You know, that usually bugs, right? You just walk around all of a sudden, oh, I'm so itchy, and then you got this big mark, and oh, that was a mosquito, or that was a, you know, whatever, bitch, or you got stung by a bee or something. We don't know. Sometimes the light has to shine on us so we see what's happening to us, so that we know and understand what's going on. The venom bursts inside and burns inside of us, and it eats away at us. That's the power that sin has over us. Because if we don't treat it, it only gets worse. It only spreads around. I don't know if you remember the old Western movies, always, I just always seems like it was a movie trope that somebody would be bitten by a rattlesnake, right? And what would the friend have to do? The friend would have to cut open the bite and suck out the venom. Yeah, I'd have to be really, really friendly with somebody to think even twice about that. But what happened? The venom had to be removed. Because what happened if you didn't do that? It would spread. And as soon as it hit your heart, it went through the entire body. And then you'd be dead. So it had to be saved. And that's the reminder that we have from today's lesson. That venom is within us, and we have to stop it. We have to stop it from circulating. And the only way we can do that is to seek the power of God. So we have to repent and lift our eyes and look toward God. And this time, the bronze snake has been replaced by the flesh and blood of Jesus Christ himself. The venom was traded for his sacred blood. And that's what we claim during Lent. That's what we claim all the time. But now especially, we think about it. We repent, we give up our sins, and we say, let us be cleansed. Let us be healed. Let us have new strength. Amen. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we again thank you for all the wonderful blessings you give us. And we thank you for holding up your Son on the cross that we may see him and be healed. We ask, Lord, that you help us to understand what we are looking at, who we are looking at, the sacrifice and the power and the strength of your will. Give us forgiveness and give us strength. We thank you for this gift in the name of Jesus. Amen. At this time, let us bring forth our tithes and offerings.
Thank you.